When Thin Lizzy started, I had a bit of a wild boy image, you know. I went for it because, like, I was tired of hearing rock and roll stars saying how sorry they were for themselves, you know, like how they disliked fame and how they were bothered. I jumped at it, you know, I was famous. I really went for it, hook, line and sinker.
Are you ready to rock? Are you ready to rip it up? You know what I'm talking about? Are you ready to give it up?
Rocker, renegade, and raconteur, Philip Paris Lynott was Ireland's first rock and roll international superstar.
Are you ready? If you're ready, we're ready.
With his swaggering 70s cool, he was one of the most charismatic, vibrant, and hedonistic figures to grace the rock and roll arena.
He was the ultimate Irishman, the cool black dude. I mean, you couldn't make him up. He put Irish music on the map.
Are you ready to rock?
He was a multifaceted, gregarious hedonist.
He had a certain thing about him. He was just born a star, really.
Leader of Thin Lizzy, Phil Lynott was a true rock and roll animal, but he was never the one-dimensional headbanger or one to conform to the Neanderthal heavy metal stereotype.
He had a very shy side to him, very romantic. And poetic.
He had this charm about him. And like I say, you know, you see him on stage and you think this guy is this raucous, wild Irishman. And then when you sit down and talk with him, he's soft-spoken, he's gentle, he's got a great sense of humour, and he's a total opposite.
The perception of Phil is that he was a typical rock and roller. He'd probably like everybody to have believed that.
His arrogance was a shield for his vulnerability.
Beneath that macho rock exterior, there lurked a fragile, complex character, a hopeless romantic dogged by deep insecurities.
To talk about Philip's insecurities, you'd need about 5 hours with Dr. Phil in the middle.
He was very complex. Philip was a mass of contradictions. He could be the sweetest guy in the world, or he could be the biggest asshole.
I never actually saw Phil as particularly macho, funny enough. I saw him more as an art, you know, more of as a musician and an artist.
There was a lot of sides to the man, and there was a very soft side to him as well. And there was also a very dark side. You wouldn't want to piss him off, because I did several times, and obviously I backed off because he was much too big. He'd have killed me.
With a mixture of immense talent and determination, Phil Lynott is responsible for some of the most powerful rock music of the 70s and 80s, including Whiskey in the Jar, The Boys Are Back in Town, and Dancing in the Moonlight. Phil Lynott was born to a single mother in Birmingham in 1949 during a period of extreme racial prejudice. Philomena Lynott had left Ireland to seek work in England, where she met Philip's father, Cecil Paris.
One night I went to a dance, and while I was at the dance, this very tall man walked across the room, and he was coloured, and he asked me to dance, and I danced with him. And when I went back to the corner where the ladies were, they all moved away from me because I danced with a black man. And I couldn't understand that because I had no prejudice. When I left the dance hall that night, two chaps started calling me a nigger lover, and they were going to attack me when this tall dark man that I had danced with came over and said, take your hands off her. So he defended me. After that, he asked me to go out with him, and I did.
The relationship blossomed, but Philomena was shocked to discover she was pregnant.
Philip's father, being in the Air Force, when they found out that he was going out with a white girl, he was sent off to London. And it was when he was gone that I realised the state I was in. The next thing was, I met another Irish girl, and we both told each other that we'd missed our periods, and we didn't know what to do. So we went and we bought 2 bundles of wood and some old newspapers, and we bought a little bottle of gin each. Then we dug a hole with a soup spoon, and we put the paper and the wood in the hole, and we poured the gin into a little billy can, and we warmed it, and we threw some old pennies into it. And we were told if you drank that gin, you would abort it. And I put the hutch into my, and it went up my nostrils and I started to heave. I never got that gin down me. I ended up in the hospital, and when I got there and the nurses realised I didn't have a ring on my finger, so now I was a tramp, a hussy. The nurses treated me like dirt. I ended up, I had a 9.5 pound baby boy. The moment Philip's head entered the world, they all ran for cameras. They'd never seen that like it, because he was born with a big head of curly hair. The next day, the matron walked in and she said to me, "Your landlady and landlord came up to see you, but we showed her your baby. And they've walked out and they've packed your stuff and they've dumped you here with us. Now we're going to replace you and you're going to be sent to a workhouse."
Philomena was sent to the Selly Oak home for unmarried mothers.
There was 18 unmarried mothers there, and I was the only one with a black baby, and the girls battered me. And I heard a girl saying, "That is the mother of the nigger." And it was the first time I heard Philip called a nigger. And there was a nun stood there, and I attacked the girl. And as I'm attacking her, the nun attacked me, so I attacked the pair of them. And I got the big stick out of the drum, and I'm swinging it, battering them. I didn't care if I killed them. Anyway, they got the better of me, and they pummeled me. And I was taken into a room, the committee room. And all these nuns were sitting around, and they looked like penguins. And they said, "Now then, we're going to talk about your baby being adopted." I said, "What?" And I ran out of the room. And I ran up the stairs and I grabbed Philip out of the nursery and I ran up to the fire escape. I know the thought then that I was going to commit suicide. That wasn't in my head at all. I just wanted to get away from them. A couple of days later, they came and told me Philip's father was at the door. And I said, "Get me out of here." I said, "They're going to try and take Philip off me." And he said, "I'll get you out of here. Let's go and find Diggs." But you couldn't find Diggs with a black baby. Nobody would want you. So we had to go to a place in Manchester at the time that was called Mossside.
Today it is almost impossible to imagine the hardships suffered during the early years of Philip's life.
I had no money. I was on the dole. And I used to go to the butcher and I'd say, "Could you give me a bag of bones for my dog?" I had no dog. And I was cooking on a fire, an open fire in the room, and Philip would be there hanging out of me. And then the stew, I'd make the stew with the bones, and that would last 2 days. And that's what we were surviving on. And I asked my mother, would she help me? And my mother took Philip. And it was heart-rending to leave him. I would go home to Ireland, and Mammy had still never told the neighbours that he was mine. She told them all, "Philip belongs to a friend of Phyllis's. His mother has died, and I'm looking after him for his daddy."
Up jumped Jack on the railroad track, saying, "I gotta get out of town. It's been really nice knowing you. Hope to see you around."
Phil was imbued with a unique mix of charm and charisma that would combine to make him such a major star. As one of the only black people in Ireland in the 50s, Phil always stood out from the crowd.
He had a pretty hard time in school, you know, because obviously he was just stood out completely. You know, he was slagged, the little black boy, and I think it was character building in a way for him as well, because it made him that bit more determined.
You know, when you're different, it's always difficult. Phil figured out you have to become a chameleon, really, to survive.
He said to me one day, "Oh, Ma, wait till I tell you." He said, "You know, when I used to go to school at the Christian Brothers, they used to give me a money box to go and collect for the black babies. I used to, you know, shake the box and get plenty of money," he said, "but I used to rob the box," he says, "because I was a black baby." God forgive me, I'm telling your tales now.
He decided he was going to be a certain type of Irishman. He was going to be the world's first black Irishman, and he made a point of being black and Irish.
Philip being black was an advantage to him. All our idols, all the music we were listening to was black music.
I was having a discussion with somebody about the band and Philip, and they said he's a black guy. And this fellow said, no, he's not black, he's Irish. And I thought, yeah, that is a real compliment to Phil, because he managed to get through things like that, and he managed to break through people.
He was so staunchly Irish. The black thing didn't enter into it. You know, I never even thought of Phil as being black.
Down from the glen came the marching men with their shields and their swords to fight the fight they believed to be right, overthrow the overlord to the town.
It was while Phil was still at school that he joined his first band, the Black Eagles.
They were like a pop band, really. I saw them for the first time in some place over in over around Harold's Cross. It was all in tennis clubs and social clubs that all these things were happening. He didn't have any of that sort of swagger or rat like that. He hadn't developed it at this stage, but he was always a great frontman. We didn't really have any, you know, anybody you could measure him up against until Jimi Hendrix hit the scene, and then, he looks a bit like Jimi.
I was lucky enough to meet Jimi Hendrix many years before, and they were the same sort of type. On stage, they were just electric. And off stage, they were the quietest people, and easygoing, and no airs and graces about them.
Phil progressed through the ranks of the Black Eagles, and after a brief stint with band Kama Sutra, was approached by musician Brush Shields to join Skid Row, a band that quickly achieved critical acclaim.
The quality I was looking for was somebody who looked like Jimi Hendrix, and so there was only two coloured guys in Ireland at the time. And one of them was a good-looking guy, and the other guy's name was Mickey Dwyer, and he wasn't bad-looking. But I knew Phil had been in a band, but he looked unbelievable. You know, charisma wasn't a word we used then, he just had presence. As he got more confident, it became more apparent that he had it all the time. And I knew he only had to get in front of the band and everything would work.
Phil was the perfect frontman, but Brush felt his vocals needed work and developed an unusual method to improve his vocal technique.
Well, I'd read somewhere that Frank Sinatra had stuck his head in a bucket of water every so often. Frank Sinatra and not Phil, to stay down there as long as you can, and that helps your breathing. And so I tried that with Phil. I stuck his head in the bucket of water. Whether it worked or not, I don't know, but it's a good idea. If you can imagine, we were four guys. There was Gary, Noel, myself and Phil, and every night we're out together, we're having a great time, we're getting ready to take off. This is it, we're on our way. I'd seen a film years ago called The Defiant Ones by Tony Curtis and Sidney Poitier. There was a black guy and a white guy, and they escaped from prison with handcuffs on. I said, this is the way to do it. So he said, we'd come out on stage, but before we went on, we'd ripped the shirt a little bit at the back and kind of stuck it back together a bit. So we'd go out, and then there'd be a bit of tension between me and him. Then we'd pull apart, and I'd get behind him. I'd reef the shirt off him, you know, and it was brilliant. And then I would throw the bass at him like a Scud missile, and then he'd throw a chair. And so the chair hit the back of the stage. And then all the bouncers, who were guys who actually played for the rugby team in UCD, they all jumped up and grabbed me, Simon Phillip. But we never looked back after that. That was a great start.
Skid Row, like, we're just too complicated, you know, for us guys. We weren't ready for all that sort of time changes. You know, you had Gary, you mean, on guitar, and Noel Bridgman, the most subtle drummer in Ireland, and the Brush on the bass, and Philip out front. They were huge. They used to pack places out.
Philip would end up standing at the side of the stage for half the gig, because they were very progressive rock, and they used to do 7-minute songs and 10-minute drum solos. So Philip didn't get much of a chance to sing.
Phil's involvement with Skid Row was short-lived.
He was having trouble singing. It wasn't that he was in the wrong key. He was in the right key, but he wasn't singing properly. He was having trouble breathing, really. And I looked down his throat, and he said, there's something down there. And I looked down, and he had a tonsil as big as a golf ball. I've never seen anything like it. It was like that. So I said, you'll have to get that sorted out. So he rang Phyllis over in Manchester, and Phyllis said she would bring him over.
I had to have him flown over to Manchester to have his tonsils out. Meanwhile, There was these three beautiful girls, triplets, long blonde hair, stunning looking. And I said to them, come on around, you've got to come and visit my son in hospital with me and we'll play a joke on him. And we got around and I said to the matron, put nurse's uniforms on the three of them. And when I go in and sit talking to Philip, send them in one at a time. So I go in and I'm sitting there, how are you? And he's going, I can hardly talk because he's had his tonsils out, you see. The door opened and in walked Cindy. And she was stunning. And she said, open your mouth. And she stuck it in. And he went, bit of nice stuff there. His eyeballs was telling me, she's nice, isn't she, right? The door opens again and in walks the second triplet and they're identical. He thought he was seeing double. And in walked the third one. And then he went, oh, Jesus, Ma, what have they given me? He thought he was seeing treble. But Cindy had walked up to him and she was pretending she had to pull back the clothes. She had a measuring tape. She said she should come to measure his will. Well, I...
Peter Brand pulled his hair and sand for the police. Policemen came, took Peter's name. God may rest in peace.
Ultimately, Brush decided to let Phil go.
Brush Shield sacked him. He said that he wasn't a good singer.
That was the worst night we had, you know, of all the nights. We were just over here coming out of Zodiac, called him outside and said, Phil, I have to let you go. You know, he didn't believe me, he thought I was joking. You know, and just out there, man. That's where it was. Never looked back after it.
Back in Manchester, Philomena and partner Dennis Keeley had opened a hotel, the Clifton Grange, which catered for a showbiz clientele.
It was like the hangout, you know, for people who work late, mostly from casinos and clubs and me. And it was like, it was the old-fashioned shebeen. And she had her sentinel upstairs, leaning out the window, making sure that, you know, the right people got in. And it was just a wonderful hangout. And Phil would come in once in a while.
But he used to come over. And he'd be fascinated with the hotel and he'd say, ah, oh, Jesus, man, who have you got famous now staying in the hotel?
He'd sit in the hotel sometimes when he was there and there was a narrow passage here and he'd stretch his legs out. So he'd have to keep stepping across and keep stepping across back. He could try and irritate you sometimes that way.
It was one of those places where as long as you signed in, you could stay all night drinking. I remember me and a friend, we both got absolutely, completely kaleid talking to George Best. And I mean, I passed out. Apparently, I was put to bed by a stripper. But the next day, he rang me up and said, you know, we're managing George Best. I said, no. He said, yeah. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, apparently, he agreed for us to manage him last night. I said, you wouldn't believe it. And of course, that was just all of us being drunk.
It was like a madhouse, literally a madhouse. Philip wrote a song about it on his first album called Clifton Grange Hotel.
We came down for breakfast, and I was sitting around the big table with transvestites and all these people that used to stay there, showbiz people, right? Really weird. And I'd never seen this before. I was like, whoa, what's the current? And Philomena cooked this huge big breakfast. Eat that. And I'm like, I'm not hungry. Eat it. All right. And the kitchen's right there. She goes, you go up and wash your hair now, Robbo. I went, no, I'm just gonna go do the gig and that's it. She said, you're not going on television like that without your hair washed. You show me up. And she grabbed me by the hair, dragged me into the kitchen, stuck my head under the tap, put fairy liquid all over it, wetted it and did it into a foam and then said, right, now rinse it out. And I did. And it all went fart. In the 70s, that was all right. It was like a perm or something. But, she wouldn't have us going on. She wouldn't let me go on like that.
Wild one, won't you please come home? You've been away too long. We need you home, we need you near.
Phil's career was progressing in a new direction. He was learning to play bass. Ironically, it was Bruce Shields who was giving him lessons.
When I was teaching him how to play the bass, I thought, this is grand now. At least he'd be out there doing something and enjoying himself and having a bit of crack. He won't feel too bad. Never occurred to me that he'd be going past me at some stage. So he came over every day from his house on the 22 bus, came straight to my house. He got off, he walked across, came in the door, blessed himself in the Holy Waterfront, which my mother thought was only beautiful. He came over every day for 6 weeks and then for 6 months after that, periodically. And at the end of 6 weeks, like, he was ready to take on the world, you know.
Now Phil formed his own band. He called it Orphanage.
The Orphanage was a bit like, it was like a band of gypsies, because, you know, there was all these moving members. So tonight the band could be four people, the next night it could be five people. It could start as a five piece, it could end as a seven piece or a nine piece. It was an experimental thing until Eric put the screws on them.
I went down to the Bailey bar one night and met this other guy called Eric Rickson, who was the original keyboard player with them. So we ended up going to this club, and then he said, did you ever try LSD? And I said, no. And he said, do you want to try some? And I said, yeah. So he gave me a little thing. Around that time, the band came on. Turned out it was Orphanage, and it was Phil in it. Lee, he was singing, lead singer, but he didn't play any instrument. And he looked really cool guy and amazing shapes and great singer and so on. At this point, the acid started kicking in, you know. I just said, who is this guy? I want him for my band. I thought the acid trip was over. So I sort of felt pretty normal. And I walked over to the changing room and I knocked the door. They heard this voice saying, come in. And I walked in and it was Philip and Brian sitting there, and they're sort of looking at me, you know, and all of a sudden the acid started kicking in again, and I went, and I just started walking around the room, giggling at everything. And I said, are you okay? I said, well, it's my first trip on acid. And they went, what? Like, what? What's it like? And I tried to explain it was impossible. So anyway, the acid sort of wore off, and I said, well, actually, I'm looking for a bass player and drummer to start a band, to start a three-piece group, like Hendrix or Cream or something. Do you know anyone? Phil turned around to Bran and said, listen, Bran, Orphanage has went as far as it can go. Do you fancy forming a group with Eric? And Bran said, no. And I said, oh, well, that's that. And then Phil insisted. He kept on saying to Bran, listen, you know, We've done the circuit loads of times and there's nothing happening. Let's start a new band. And Brian gave up and says, all right, Phil, whatever you want to do.
So from a simple chance encounter, Thin Lizzy were born. It was 1970. The Thin Lizzy lineup was Phil on bass and vocals, Brian Downey on drums, and Eric Bell on lead guitar.
Philip just summed it up. He said, I want to be rich and famous.
It was in an Isabar. This was called the Zodiac Bar. It was down here that he really felt he had the unit that could go the distance.
I keep thinking that Thin Lizzy was meant to be because of all the things that happened. I mean, why was I in that club that night? And why was Orphanage playing? There was one point when Thin Lizzy had just started. We'd been together about 6 weeks. Philip said, listen, Eric, if we're getting an electric group together, I think we should live together, like a commune. So I said, yeah, it sounds a good idea. He says, I'm going to go out in a few days and I'm going to dress up in a suit and a shirt and a tie and so on, and I'm going to try and get us a nice place to live. So about 3 or 4 days later, we arranged to meet in some cafe. And he came in and he was all dressed up in a suit and a shirt and a tie. And he sort of went, I've got them. And he had the keys to this place in Clontarf, which is a pretty up Marketplace in Dublin. So we went out to see it, and it was a really nice place. It was at the top of this house in Castle Avenue. It was crazy. And what happened was, we got this reputation of having these all-night parties. And all these guys that come in, all these girls and things, you know, 20, 30 people there some nights. So, I mean, God love the people who live downstairs.
The flat was cluttered mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually and financially. There was actually no room in it whatsoever to do anything. But it was full of guys who all thought they were going to do something. So consequently, they would put up with each other's idiosyncrasies.
I remember that hobble of a squabble.
The neighbours wanted them out, so they were going, like, it's ridiculous. They were coming in all hours of the day and night. You know, they look fairly wild with the long hair and looking like they've been doing all the things that the people next door wish they could be doing, but that's, what can you do? And don't forget, this is like 1969 or whatever, when people, that type of thing didn't happen in that particular area.
So everyone was, this petition came round to try and get us out, signed by all the neighbours. But somehow we stayed, for a while anyway.
Thin Lizzy went from strength to strength, and in under 6 months were signed by the Parlophone label.
We walked into the studio and the guy said, yeah, can you bring your equipment and set it up in here? So we started bringing in the amps and the drums and the keyboards, and at one point myself and Philip had one of these big long columns for the PA. And we brought it in and the guy said, oh, you won't need that. And we sort of went, oh yeah, you know, as if we knew. Of course we didn't. He says, you don't need to sing through that in here, you can sing through microphones. So we sort of looked at him a bit embarrassed and took it out in the van again. And we recorded The Farmer.
Thin Lizzy's first single, The Farmer, sold under 300 copies.
It wasn't really a big hit, and it definitely wasn't burning up the airplays.
And they were promptly dropped by Parlophone. Fortunately, a talent scout from record label Decca happened to be in the right place at the right time.
Frank Rogers came over from Decca and he was looking for talent, music talent in Ireland. So we ended up going to this club in Dublin called Dr. Shivargo's, I think it was. And we were just in the background, myself, Philip and Bran. And Frank Rogers and one of our managers at that point was standing on the empty dance floor looking up at us on the stage. And after that, Frank Rogers came over to us and said, I'm very impressed with the band and... Would you like a recording contract with Decca, you know? And we went, you know, you're joking, basically. So about a week later, we were on the boat to London.
Up jumped John, putting his trousers on. I gotta get out of here. I hear your lover's footsteps. It's coming too near for me, my dear.
Not only was Phil a highly gifted songwriter, musician and vocalist, both on and off the stage, he was admired for his ultra-cool demeanor and genuine style.
Making love against the wall.
I thought I was a cool dresser, but I mean, he was so much cooler always, so I'd nick some of his clothes or he'd give me some of his clothes to wear, you know what I mean? What I loved was walking into a room with him because, I mean, he walked into a room, the whole place came alive. It wasn't because I walked into a room.
You only had to look at him, really, and you could see he's a rock star.
My dress sense was dreadful. Most people's was in the 70s, but he had a certain thing about him. Image was a big thing with him, big thing. And that carried on into the music as well.
He always had a nice way of being able to get clothes off the girls. One wear, oh, that's very nice. Oh, I like that top. And so he was able to, you know, he got a fair few things like that that he would wear. No problem, you know, he just adapted them.
And Phil was well into clothes. He loved clothes. And he'd be going, oh, look at that, man. Look at the trousers your man is on, you know, look at those boots, look at that jacket. And we'd end up going around all these shops and Dandenong Market and all with Philip, who'd buy, like, tons of second-hand clothes.
You had that thing, you know. When you can't teach it to somebody. You either have it or you don't have it. And he had it.
March 1972, Thin Lizzy were invited to support Slade on their UK tour.
Slade was just the biggest thing in the country then. They were just enormous. I think the first or second night we played, we didn't know what to expect. We walked on and the place was stuffed. I mean, there was like, it looked like thousands upon thousands of people. And we walked on and we never really thought about it and just played the same set as what we would play in a pub. And we just died a death. The audience were just going, "We want Slade, we want Slade."
Slade were managed by ex-Animals bass player Chas Chandler, the man who discovered Jimi Hendrix.
After we finished our set, we went into the changing room and Chas Chandler came in and he says, "Right, boys, if that's what your show is like, you're off the tour." He says, "We didn't bring you on to send the audience to sleep. If you don't get it together, you're off." And Phil just went. The guy was devastated, you know. And he was on the point of crying because this was his hero's manager was telling him that we were basically no good. The next night, God love Philip, I looked over at him. Every now and again, he would throw this ship, you know. He'd be out the front with a bass for about 4 seconds, and then he'd go back to being shy Philip. And then about 3 minutes later, he would do another one, which lasts for about 5 seconds, and then he'd go back again to being shy Philip. He started very gradually checking the audience out and feeling more at home with them and realising, God, I did this pose and nobody threw anything at me.
Phil wasn't a particularly confident frontman at the beginning, which is quite hard to believe now. By the end, there were very few people that could work an audience quite the way that Phil could.
There's loads of people who can play exceptionally well, and like that little thing that takes him to the next point. And when he got confident, you know, the whole world was there for him.
But he had a hunger to want everybody to know him, or to know his work and his music and the band. And, I mean, we got pretty close, I think.
He used to come up stage and say to me, "How do you think it looked? You know, what do you think of the shapes?" You go, "Brilliant." I mean, he just knew how to do that. For a bass player to sing and to throw shapes like that, everyone has copied him since. Everyone.
Thin Lizzy's first hit single came about through a mixture of luck and perversity. The original A-side, Black Boys on the Corner, was penned by Phil and he felt it was hit material. For the B-side, they recorded a rock version of the old Gaelic folk song Whiskey in the Jar. Phil took the unprecedented step of recording this track with no bass line.
I was very young. You know, I was a very young producer. I was green. And we just weren't getting the vibe. So Phil was turning around and said, "Look, let's just do it live like we do on stage." And Eric said, "Well, why not? You know, it won't do any harm." And they did it in one take. And that's actually the take that went out. And it's just magic.
Against Phil's wishes, Decca flipped the sides and the single Whiskey in the Jar shot to number 6 in the UK charts. Yes, I was going over.
The first time the hair stood out on the back of my neck was when I saw Thin Lizzy on Top of the Pops with Whiskey in a Jar.
When Whiskey in a Jar became a hit, Philip completely realised, my God, I've went from the back streets of Dublin to be on Top of the Pops, you know, waving out at all the guys in Dublin that used to think I was a nut or a total time waster or a dreamer. I've actually made it come true.
Whiskey in the Jar, I mean, every time it comes on, you just can't help singing along.
Till this day, Whiskey in the Jar could be one of the two biggest songs in Ireland, and the other is the national anthem.
I mean, it is one of the finest rock tracks of that period.
I know he rocked up a beautiful old Irish ballad, but funnily enough, I don't know how to put it, he loved his other stuff better.
Oh!
Phil never did things by half. He lived life at a pace that astounded those who knew him.
He'd be going day and night. So whatever it took to keep him going day and night, he would take the go day and night. He didn't want to sleep. He didn't want to stop.
He never relaxed. He never slept much.
Philip had an addictive personality. He had the constitution of an ox. He was Johnny the Fox. He just, whatever he did, whatever Philip did, he did it big time.
He was a big drinker. I drink brandy. He could drink a bottle while I was having two glasses, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I couldn't keep up with him. He was unbelievable. Many a time I've ended up not being able to walk with Phil just standing there going, what's the matter? He had hollow legs, I'm sure.
Well, the nights out we had, and we had many, basically, by the end of it, we couldn't remember whether we had a good night or a bad night. We just went out and got totally wasted. But it was just, that's what we did. We just went out. It was just great company.
He just liked partying, to be perfectly honest.
Oh, he believed he was immortal, certainly. He believed nothing could ever happen to him, but that's a very Irish characteristic.
After the huge success of Whiskey in the Jar, Phil and his band found themselves under increasing pressure.
I noticed when Whiskey in the Jar came out that things started changing dramatically. We're starting to get pressure then from the record company. You know, we want another hit, lads, or you're going to be a one-hit wonder. And I was told one night, after we come off the stage, I was told, Eric, the guitar solos are too long. You're boring the audience to death. And I'm going, what? I said, you stick to your effing office and stick to the phone. You know, I don't come in and tell you how to talk on the phone. Don't tell me how to play the guitar.
The pressure was to be compounded by Phil's ever-present search for musical perfection.
He was pragmatic when he thought that's as far as he could go or that was the best he could do at the time, but he was definitely a perfectionist. He always was striving to do better with his music and with his performance and with the band. And, you know, he always thought that there was more to be had.
Work was difficult because we were all sort of perfectionists and you'd only have to make one little mistake to get it in the neck.
I always left the dressing room at least 10 minutes before we went on. And as I closed the door, you could hear the roars, somebody getting a rollicking and sorting out something that happened wrong on the show before, you know.
Verbally, we would throw it back and forth. And so I learned a lot. But the initial thing of him being right all the time, hated it. Because I'm right all the time. But we kind of went like that. And so I'd learned a lot. And I took on a lot of his traits without really knowing it.
You know, he was tough. He didn't suffer fools gladly. And if you went down the wrong road with Phil, he would say so. But he was not intimidating, and he was not cruel, and he was not mean. He just wanted to get the job done.
Thin Lizzy's future now seemed assured. The next album was to be Vagabonds of the Western World.
It wasn't until Vagabonds that they started to become Thin Lizzy, the famous Thin Lizzy that everyone knew and loved.
We released the third single, The Rocker, and we all thought that was going to take off. And it didn't. It got somewhere in the top 40, but it didn't become a hit. And that's when the change started really happening. Philip then, he was hungry for the Top of the Pops, the adulation, the hit again. You know, he wanted that again.
When Vagabonds sold poorly, Thin Lizzy were unceremoniously dropped by Decca. The strain was beginning to take its toll on Eric Bell.
I got into this sort of lifestyle, you know, as bands do, and I couldn't stop drinking. I don't think I was straight one night in 3 years, and I kept thinking, Jesus, man, what's going on here, you know? Have you got a bit of a problem? Like, I couldn't stop drinking, and then I needed, even though it was only hash, I needed it to play. And that's one of the reasons I left, and myself and Philip had a fight, you know, the first fight we ever had. We had it in this horrible tour we did in Germany. And things between us were a bit sort of tense after that, you know.
Eric quit the band.
I was so proud of Thin Lizzy and being in it. But I just kept toying with the idea, I'm going to leave, you know, I got to get out of here, you know, it's not going the way I want anymore. I've been there and I've done that and I got the straitjacket.
It seemed Thin Lizzy would be consigned to the one-hit wonder bin. But for someone as determined as Philip, giving up was not an option. He recruited 20-year-old Scott Gorham and the 17-year-old Brian Robbo Robertson and the mighty and unforgettable powerhouse that was Thin Lizzy. was reborn.
Rocker! Down at the juke joint, me and the boss are standing, dipping and bopping and telling a dirty joke. It walked this chick, I knew she was up to something, and I kissed her right there out of the blue. I said, hey baby, meet me, I'm a tough guy.
I got the gig simply because my best friend at the time I went to school with, Big Charlie, who was a Thin Lizzy roadie. I was a terrible little tow rag. I really was. 17 and class reading in a bit, you know. Plus the fact I knew all the materials, so Phil wanted to go out as a three-piece, same as he did with Eric. I can't quite remember whether I said no or Brian Downey said no, or it might be me and Brian ganging up. But we wanted a rhythm player in, and then we started looking and we found Scott. So that's how it kind of went. Well, the very first gig we did together as a band, and we started playing, and me and Phil were jumping around like idiots, and Scott was just standing by his amplifier going, what the hell are they doing? Because we were like throwing shapes all over the place, and Scott was like, I can't believe this. He was like completely mortified.
She's quite the mediator, smoother operator you will never see. See you later, no one day I disobey her openly. She knows music, I know music too, you see. She got the power, I got the power, Rosalie. Rosalie, Rosalie, yeah.
Most people regard the Scott Gorham, Brian Robertson lineup as the classic lineup of Thin Lizzy. It wasn't until they joined on guitar that they really upped the tempo and made the music a lot heavier.
The boys were good, you know.
It'll be nice to see a rock and roll band that can live up to Thin Lizzy.
Phil basically was what made Thin Lizzy special. There was a floating personnel that used to go in and out of the band, but at the core of it, Phil was what made it unique.
Thin Lizzy's next albums, Nightlife and Fighting, were not well received, and sales fell short of the band's expectations.
Nightlife was kind of disjointed in a lot of ways because we were trying to find our way.
Fighting was probably a transition period at that time.
The record company felt that they didn't have a visual image of the band itself, and they wanted a photograph, and they got this dreadful fucking picture of, I think Brian Robinson's carrying an iron bar, you know what I mean? And I just remember looking at it thinking, that's everything Philip or I would never want in Lizzy to be, a tug band.
They eventually triumphed with the 1976 release of Jailbreak, one of the finest hard rock records ever.
Jailbreak obviously was the seminal album, if you like.
Jailbreak came next, and that was sensational. At that stage, Philip was getting a lot of power with her, a lot of clout and a lot of power with the record company.
And it wasn't really until they got to Jailbreak that they really became the tour de force that we now know them as.
It was a defining moment for the band. The album was crammed with top draw rock anthems, Jailbreak, Emerald, and The Boys Are Back in Town, an homage to male bonding, which became Lizzy's signature tune.
Change that much to say that I still think that that's so crazy. Never asked me if you were around, how you was, where you could be found. Told me that you make a living downtown, driving all the old men crazy. The boys are back in town,
boys are back in town,
boys are back in town.
I like The Boys Are Back in Town for a lot of reasons, because I make a living out of it some nights, you know.
The Boys Are Back in Town, which I call my theme tune. Over the years when I've been ill or gone through a bad time, I said to my girlfriend recently, when someone broke my jaw recently in a fight, and when it started getting better, I just said to her, the boys are back in town.
Note for note, it's just awesome.
The success of Jailbreak and The Boys Are Back in Town shot Thin Lizzy to international superstardom. They quickly achieved rock and roll notoriety, with Phil gaining a reputation as the hard man of rock.
No, it was totally a gang. Oh, yeah. It was just like, you know, drag yourself around the world and cause havoc wherever you can. And we did most of the time. It's just that I got blamed for most of it. Phil was smart. Any of the problems we had on the road, right, usually got blamed on me, and Phil went, that's nothing to do with me. No matter what he did, you'd get blamed for it. So I got used to that. I was like a little dog behind him most of the time. I'm going, you cause the havoc and I'll back you up.
Behind Phil's macho posturing, there lay a deeply sensitive, even spiritual person absorbed by Celtic mythology and Irish history.
It was a very spiritual side to Philip that I don't think most people could even comprehend. The Catholic ethos had filtered deep into his system, much more than mine, because he was a fanatic Catholic. He was a fanatic admirer of Irish nationalism, and we used to joke a lot about it, but he was serious.
Very religious, you know, it sort of shocked me at times. Like us guys were all trying to get rid of the shackles that we had, you know, that we'd grown up with. And Philip was always very spiritual.
But he was never a preacher. He's one of those people that I think he had his own row to lead. And I think Phil was very careful about who he opened up to at that depth of his personality.
It was a side maybe it came out of him more in his writing or whatever, but not... not on a day-to-day basis.
He was a proud Irishman. That's his spirituality. He was very much into Irish history, and that whole side of his persona, some people might think that that was all put on, but in actual fact it wasn't. He, politically, maybe he was a wee bit free Ireland. You know, didn't much like Ian Paisley, I don't think, but there you go.
Phil's passions ran deep. On a par with his love for music, there was also a huge devotion to football.
If he hadn't been gifted musically, he would have loved to have been a footballer. End of story. That was his dream, yes.
But I think a lot of musicians and footballers in particular, I think, you know, you ask most footballers, if they had a second career, they'd pick music. And if you ask most musicians, they would pick football. You know, it's the same with Elton John and Rod Stewart. Yeah, Robbie Williams, they're all football fanatics. And we were the same, you know, footballers wanted to be rock musicians if they had a second choice.
Football played a huge part in Philip's life. He was a massive Man United fan. Obviously, George Best was his hero, because I think in Black Rose, he says something like, "Georgie, you're the best."
He never actually ever said to me, you know, you're one of my heroes. And I never actually said to him. I think we both knew that we had this mutual admiration for each other. Which is why we didn't have to say anything. And I think you find that with certain people, you don't have to say it.
During interviews and that, he'd break an interview to go and check to see how Man United were doing, if it was a Saturday and there was a match on. And every 5 minutes he kept saying, "Oh, that guy's got to go, look at this." And his attention was taken away completely from the interview.
And he wouldn't miss a match. I mean, he'd nearly put the gig back until the match was over. And he even went as far, when he did get some money, to buy some shares in Manchester United.
The 1978 release of Live and Dangerous secured Thin Lizzy's status as rock icons. It became the biggest selling Lizzy album of all time, shifting over 500,000 copies in the UK alone.
Live and Dangerous, of course, is still regarded as the definitive double live record. It's hard to disagree with that. Don't believe a word.
There's a Live and Dangerous album, which has been voted greatest live album of all time, which it probably is.
When Live and Dangerous was made, just after it became a hit, Philo came back and to do a gig at the Baggot Inn in Dublin, and everybody wanted to get in, and everybody wanted an interview. And after the gig, he had said nobody into the dressing room, and I sneaked in with my tape recorder. And he looked at me and he kicked the tape recorder up in the air and he said, "My life's not one long bleeding interview, you know?" But we had a great laugh about it afterwards.
After Live and Dangerous and all that, right, I really felt that he wanted to broaden out. He wanted to get in some brass players and all. But there was always this thing about the management and money and a tour of America or a tour of Japan. They wanted him to get out there and play that Live and Dangerous set until they died.
When a band goes out to LA or America, period, okay, you've toured Britain, you've toured Ireland, you've toured Europe, but the big one is America. And it's not just for the money. It's a whole culture thing, isn't it? Rock and roll, America. And yeah, he wanted to be there, do that. But I still think that he thought he could influence them. He wasn't going out there for them to influence him. He wanted to them. And I was right behind him, I went, yeah.
During 1978, Phil also began a brief musical flirtation with punk.
He always had his finger on the pulse. He was smart enough to hook up with the Sex Pistols, do the Greedy Bastards stuff, which was amazing. I loved it.
The Greedies were a project that basically came together after Phil had been guesting on a solo record by Johnny Thunders, formerly of the New York Dolls. Steve Jones and Paul Cook were both on that record, and they decided it would be just fun to do some recreational activities. And they put together the band, threw together the band might be a better term, played a couple of shows, made a Christmas single, made a wodge of cash, and the Greedies were born.
The Greedy Bastards were just a blast. It was money in their pocket without the management knowing it. And, you know, like the punk thing, like that was the start of the rot, you know, for rock and roll.
1980, Thin Lizzy were bona fide rock stars. It was also a year of major change for Phil. His first solo album, Solo in Soho, was released, and he married Caroline Crowther, the mother of his two daughters.
Phil met Caroline, which she was the daughter of Leslie Crowther, a very famous television presenter. When Phil got married, we all got invited, so he invited all his side, which were just lunatics, rock and roll people, you know, the leather-clad lot, roadies, press, the management, everyone, all of us. And then obviously Leslie Crowther would invite his people, which was like all the showbiz people, the more straighter people, the variety of television. And so on one side of the room, it was hysterical. One side of the room was all these people getting hammered, like all the rock people. And then the other side of people was all the other people that were getting hammered, but in a much more refined sort of English way. And so we're all sitting there, and then there was all the speeches and everything. And then Leslie Crowther got up, and he was brilliant. He, you know, made this speech about Phil, you know, how he'd been introduced to her, him and how Caroline and him had fallen in love. And he said, and Leslie liked to drink and everything. And so he got up and he said, well, you know, I met Phil and he was a very nice young man. And he did the traditional thing. He said to me, "I would like your daughter's hand in marriage." And I turned to him and said, "Well, you've had everything else. You might as well have that." And the whole of the rock side, or the whole of the music business side just fell about. And all the other side, it was like really quiet and they all just looked around. It was just brilliant. And Phil was just in tears. It was just classic.
I think he would have killed to be a happily married man with children and be a grandfather. But the pressures of life were, you know, very heavy on him. But Philip felt, because he was the rocker, that he had to be the stud. And that was one of the problems too. These contradictions that would kill people.
Phil and monogamy were uneasy bedfellows. His underlying vulnerability made him irresistible to women.
Terrible Romeo. No, not terrible. He was a great Romeo. For all my brashness in those days, I was with girls, I was absolutely useless. And you'd see him every night. So I start trying to pick up his pickup lines. Oh, you got lovely eyes, haven't you? But it doesn't work with a Glaswegian accent. Phil with the deep Dublin, oh, no, you're lovely. And the girls are going, yeah. And I tried and it didn't work.
I think that he had a lot of attention from women, just purely the nature of who he was and what he did and the way he did it.
Yeah, he loved women, yeah. Well, we all did, but he had it down to a fine art, you know.
We probably got that wasted most times, that women at the end of the night didn't really come into it. We'd lost in it. We'd look and talk about it and laugh and joke and, you know, what big men we were going to be. We were going to take 2, 3, 4 home. But by the time we'd finished drinking and whatever Phil was up to, that had gone out the window. We just enjoyed each other's company and went our own way.
How can I say this politely? Philip had an avaricious appetite for everything.
And we'd been on the road for several months. So he'd been, shall we say, quite active on the female front. And we're in this little dressing room down in the basement. There was a toilet at the end with a wooden door. So you could actually, look, there's men's toilets, you can actually see people's feet underneath. I had previously burnt a hole in my finger from falling asleep with a cigarette completely wrecked. So the doctor had given me some cream to put on it. Phil went to the toilet and he said, my thing is a bit sore. So I gave this cream that he'd given, the doctor had given me, to Scott, because I knew what it would do, right? Because I had already put it on, I know what's gonna happen, right? So I said, Scott, give that to him. So Scott went over to the toilet and gave it to him. We were just about to go on stage, so he had the leathers on, right? So underneath the door, you could see the leathers and the boots. And all of a sudden, there was, oh, you fucking bastard! Because he put the cream on his dick. And of course, it just singed it off. So all we saw was, under that gap, the feet. Going like that. Oh, fuck's sake, like that. And then come back down again, and then he came out and he said, D-d-d-d-d. So we had to go at Scott because he thought it was Scott's cream. It wasn't, it was mine. But I got away with it, and we did the gig. And all it wasn't any disease or anything. He'd just been a shade too active, as he always was.
Well, I'm tough, I'm rough, I'm ready, and I'm able to pick myself up from under this table. Don't you stick no sign on me, I got no label. I'm a little unsure of sound and unstable.
The immense success of Thin Lizzy would have its price. The pressure of life in an iconic rock band put Phil under increasing strain.
Well, I'm busting out. For Philip Famous, a deadly poison chalice, it couldn't have been any more poisoned.
For somebody like Phil, it's very difficult to really make a judgment on people hanging on, because you do get a large amount of people that are genuine friends and people that want to be involved on a genuine level. And because of his nature, and he was a gent, and he did like to party, like we, you know, and socialise like we all do. And I think people took advantage of that at certain times.
You could play to 70,000 people and it might have no effect on you. Like, you're out there and you're doing it. But once you've got there, once you get to wherever you're going, you find that there's actually nothing there. So the more famous you get, the further you get away from wherever you thought it was going to be.
The world created out of Philip and Thin Lizzy a wham bam thank you ma'am type of superstar. And Philip was never comfortable with that. But on the other hand, he had to live up to the image, and in a way that's what destroyed him.
Living and dying in Chinatown. Living and dying down in old Chinatown. In Chinatown.
By 1982, Thin Lizzy's popularity had peaked and record sales had begun to falter. Ultimately trapped by his own hard man image, Phil stumbled towards escalating drug use.
The life you live in that business is full of an awful lot of very evil people who congregate around people like Philip, especially when they weaken. And Philip weakened.
By now, the drug of choice was heroin.
No one realizes how dangerous the big one is. And what happens is you're in it, and suddenly you realize you can't get out of it. And the people around him, the whole thing around him, his entourage, didn't help.
I was aware there was drugs, but I used to say to Philip, Philip, never ever go on heavy drugs. And he'd say, ah, Jesus, my everybody, we've all tried everything, and brush it aside.
I confronted him seriously about cleaning up when I heard he was on heroin, because I was genuinely shocked. He claimed to me he was smoking it. So I thought, well, that's easier to fix than injecting it. I didn't know he was injecting it. Nobody did. But he would have needed more than my help to clean up.
Because if you stand there in front of someone and say, look, in the end, I'm going to take this, and, you know, it's going to fuck me up. Didn't think anyone's going to do that. Nope.
Adding to Phil's problems, Thin Lizzy were on the verge of bankruptcy. To raise cash, the Thunder and Lightning album and farewell tour were planned, which ironically created a fresh surge of interest in the band.
Are you ready to rock? Are you ready to rip it up?
The final lineup of Thin Lizzy, the one with John Sykes on guitar and Darren Warden on keyboards, was magnificent. They had a real power, a real aggression. You really would never have guessed that it was going to be the last series of shows that they played.
Are you ready to beat it up? You ready to take it? You know what I'm thinking of? You know what I'm thinking? Are you ready to rock?
Despite the revival in Lizzy's fortune, the band finally fell apart.
The reason that Thin Lizzy broke up depends on who you believe. Some say Tony Bransby, their publicist at the time, dreamt it up as an idea to sell tickets, and the band went along with it grudgingly. I think by that time, there were certain people in the band felt that they had reached the end, it was running a little dry. But you'd never have thought that if you'd seen the shows on that tour.
And that period of music had really come to an end. He was truly heartbroken when Thin Lizzy split up, and he felt it was premature. He was devastated by the loss, and that's the right word for it, of Thin Lizzy, because they were like his family.
In the old days, I could sing the blues. I had nothing to live for.
Phil's troubles increased during 1983 with the disintegration of his marriage.
They were going through a rough time, and who's to blame anybody in that situation? They were two kids facing an enormous series of problems, a lot of it drink and drug related from Philip's point of view.
It's no secret that Phil and Caroline were having a tough time, you know, the rock and roll lifestyle and everything else like that.
He must have felt bad if he was talking to me about it. You know what I mean? That's all I'm saying.
In the end, he was just crushed.
Mama, your boy has lost control. The party's over now. Everybody's going home. The band is packing up. I'm on my own.
During this harrowing period for Phil, it was the uniquely strong relationship with his mother that held him together.
Phyllis was very private. No one knew too much about her. She probably told me more than she did anyone else. She was a very private person. And I think you could see the respect they had for each other. She was a very proud mother, quite rightly so. And he loved her to death. I mean, you could see when they got together, it was a special bond.
She was a big influence in Philip, you know, she really was. You know, she was really interested in him. And how he was doing and what he was making of his life, you know.
Everywhere he went on tour, she came. He'd sit her in a special place in the auditorium, and he'd shine the guitar up in her face. And that was the connection. He made a connection. This is for you, mother.
He loved and doted on his mother, and vice versa, I think. You know, Phil and I would go out in Dublin and stuff, and we'd come back, and You know, she really was the, you know, it was the mother and son thing, and I'd be standing to one side like it was, you know, your best mate being told off.
If you got out of hand or did anything, Phyllis was there, and by God, you wouldn't do it again. So there's a big family thing going on. And anything to do with the band, she was so precious with. And she would look after every single member. It was her family, still is.
I remember once when he was a little boy, he said, when I grow up, I'll buy you lots of perfume and I'll buy you a big, big house. And he bought me this house for my 50th birthday.
Was a raining night, the night the king went down. Everybody was crying, it seemed like sadness had surrounded.
Like many icons of the 1970s, Phil Lynott struggled to come to terms with the decade that followed. His first attempt at reinvention was to form the rock powerhouse he christened Grand Slam.
I think Lizzie had been a long trip, you know, it had been a long road trip for him. You know, he was a creative guy and, you know, we all want to write and be creative and sometimes you need a slightly different plane to go on. And I think Grand Slam was his way of doing that.
When it came to putting Grand Slam together, I think Phil chose really wisely. On keyboards, he took Mark Stanway, excellent player, a lot of experience, really good songwriter. On guitar, he took Lawrence Archer, really, really underrated guitarist. And he completed the band with pretty much two unknowns. Deutsch Nagel was the rhythm guitarist, Robbie Brennan was the drummer.
You know, we really just fell into it straight away. It was like a dream come true for me, plus Phil was a hero.
I thought they had incredible songs. Some people didn't like them just because they were different to Lizzie, but I thought that was the whole point. Mama, oh
mama. Grand Slam rapidly built up a large and loyal following.
The response was just absolutely mad. It was crazy. Something that I hadn't really seen in my career before.
There was some great stuff on the Grand Slam period. It was just, it was all just too rushed.
I said, baby, baby, baby.
They wouldn't be as greedy as the Greedy Bastards. But you know, I seen Grand Slam and with Robbie Brennan and the Ocean, the boys, and doing their best, but big trouble because you have Thin Lizzy and your Grand Slam, there's no comparison.
And they'd form Grand Slam, which is okay, but it wasn't Lizzy.
Despite Grand Slam's large fan base, they failed to sign a record deal.
There was a few bad moments in the press, which basically put a bit of a stigma on Phil's and Phil's entourage, which stopped us getting a major deal.
I think Phil was just as confused as everybody else, the fact that Grand Slam didn't get a record deal. Why they didn't get signed, I suppose you'd have to ask the nation's A&R men. They had the songs, they had the repertoire, they had the confidence, but I think his reputation as a hellraiser and perhaps just as a general loose cannon had a lot to do with that.
Following this difficult period, Phil began to enjoy solo success.
In the end, Phil did get a deal with the songs that we originally wrote for Grand Slam.
The subject of Phil's solo career is something that I still think kind of splits Thin Lizzy fans down the middle. There were those like myself that kind of craved him to do the balls out hard rock that we knew him for, and yet by the same token he was perfectly happy to go and do stuff like Yellow Pearl with Midge, which later became the theme tune for Top of the Pops, and also to experiment in things like reggae.
It was a good opportunity for him to show himself off again, show that he was still on form, show that he was still a contender.
Phil worked with Gary Moore on a couple of occasions and it was always worth waiting for. Parisian Walkways was a monster hit and justifiably so. Further down the line they got together and did Out in the Fields, which was another fantastic song. The two of them were a phenomenal partnership.
He was still extremely gifted, talented man. And he still wrote amazing lyrics, still wrote great songs, still a great singer, great showman. But he knew the direction now that he needed to go in.
He became more aware of his black roots. He started a band with black guys like Jerome. And he found himself, but he found himself just a bit too late. If you see Stevie Wonder,
The last hit that Phil had was a solo hit. It was a great song, actually, called 19, which dated back to the days of Grand Slam. But the interesting thing about it was actually produced by Paul Hardcastle, who had a hit single of his own called No, 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 19. It was the way that Phil would like to have gone had Lizzie continued, which was his intention at that time.
Despite Phil's successful solo career, life after Lizzie seemed empty to him. He had created a myth so powerful, he never managed to outgrow it. Another major blow for Phil was his exclusion from Live Aid.
Live Aid was by far the biggest gig in history at the time and the biggest gig in Philip's lifetime. And he was profoundly depressed and shocked that he wasn't invited to perform. And that precipitated his end in many ways.
Thin Lizzy were probably the archetypal rock and roll band in England. It would have dented his ego and he would have felt he's now not in contention like a heavyweight boxer. He you know, he wasn't world champion still. And I think he would have been hurt, do you know what I mean? More than angry, he'd have been really disappointed.
You know, Philip was a problem at that point in his own life, but Lizzy should have been at that.
Phil's escalating use of heroin was beginning to take its toll, despite the efforts of those closest to him.
He was on a big, massive downward spiral that included everything from amphetamines to booze to heroin to cocaine, you name it, he took it. And he felt he had the physique to withstand it, which he did. He was a very strong physique, he was a powerful man. But heroin sort of has a cortisone-like effect. It puts on weight while destroying the inner body and the inner soul.
I could see it coming. He was looking more like Elvis every day. He was putting on the weight, he was starting to bloat, you know, but you couldn't tell him. I did have a serious conversation with him one time in Glencar, and, you know, at first he was listening to me, but then he was okay. And eventually he threw me out.
Because I knew he was getting more and more seriously into the wrong side of things. And I suppose, I hate to say inevitable, but it was starting to look that way. But I never lectured him, and you do once in a while say, you know, it's not a good idea, because I've had lots of my friends who've passed away because of drugs. And the same thing happens with drink eventually. But I think drugs just speed it up a little bit.
For every guy that's trying to stop you, there's 150 trying to give you something. And all the 155 are saying that you're the biggest bollocks of all time for trying to interfere with them, you know. Unfortunately, you get a little bit of paranoid, a little paranoid with the people who like them the most.
There's no doubt about it, his persona began to disintegrate and he began to get very insecure about everything. And I speak personally about this because I was a victim of it.
He didn't want you invading his privacy. You know, he had this sort of wall. I noticed that when certain people said something to him about his lifestyle, you know, he would go, "Stay out of me fucking head."
His friends were there for him, always, you know. The problem is that Philip didn't recognise that towards the end.
Jim was doing his best, everybody was doing their best, but, you know, there's nothing you could say around that time.
He would always do what it took to sort you out. It's a bit sad that other people didn't do it for him. And I wish to God I'd have been in the position at the time to do it for him, because I would have. Unfortunately, you know, he'd got into that stage where there's too many other people about it.
We did have a long talk about the whole narcotics and drugs scenario. I was actually quite a quick, you know, clean living boy at that point. And he used to talk to me about it because I think he felt he could talk to me about it. He did say to me on many occasions, you know, that I would really like to get away from this. And there was one particular time where he did make quite a severe effort to get what we would call clean, I suppose, or away from this, you know, entourage of people that were, you know, barraging it towards him.
Once Phil's addiction took hold, he used heroin not to get high, but to feel normal.
Phil was the opposite to the self-destruct. Phil was a self-preservationist. I don't think he was going down that road of self-destruction at all. I think that's something that everyone says about someone that either dies or has an experience with it, or yeah, they're into self-destruction. Yeah, I don't think most people self-destruct on purpose.
And, you know, who's to say some people can do that and live on till whatever age and do whatever, but I wouldn't, you know, it wasn't a purposely self-destructive lifestyle.
There's a lot of guys who got very heavily into drugs and got off them. And I reckon that he was in the process of getting off them, that's my opinion. And at this day I believe that if everything had been going well, he would have got off them. That's all I know. And that's what he said, and I believed him.
It was Christmas time, and I arrived at the house, and he was spending a lot of time in bed, but the Christmas tree was up, the stockings were hanging on the mantelpiece, the Christmas tree was packed with all the prezzies, named, labelled, you name it, and I noticed that there was a drip coming down from the ceiling in the hallway, and I ran up the stairs, and my Philip was lying in a bath, full of water, in full blue jeans. And the water was flowing over. He was like floating. I said, Mercy, what is going on? I pulled the plug out. He said, Ma'am, I'm freezing. I don't know how I did it. He was 6 foot odd, and the weight of his jeans, and I got him out of that bath. And I got him to the bed. He leaned on me. I got him to the bed, and I started to take his clothes off, but he didn't want me to touch his trousers. I said, I brought you into the world. I'm taking those trousers off. And I got him, and I wrapped him in everything. And I warmed him as best I could, and that was that. I got him to the hospital, and the next time I saw him, he was in a bed. And he was there, and he was propped up, and he was able to speak. And I sat at the foot of the bed, and I said, give us a smile, and he went, I thought, that's fine. I didn't know Philip was going to die, but he did ask for a priest before he died, and somebody told me, the priest is coming to see Philip. I said, no, don't bring a priest in to see Philip. I said, if he sees his colour, I said, he'll get a fright. They said, Philip has asked for the priest. Philip asked for the priest.
The phone rang while I was cooking, and I answered it, and it was Charlie. And he said, he's gone. That's the last thing I remember. I hit the deck and woke up in a cab on the way to the hospital. Something around my head.
I just got a phone call.
I've been crying for about 2 days. I did, I was devastated.
We were all hurt, you know? All very hurt, you know? We got a little, as the guy says, we lost the plot for a while, you know? And you'd be kind of, you wouldn't know whether you're feeling sorry for Phil or feeling sorry for yourself.
I was in deep shock, really, for quite some time. I felt like a big part of my life had gone.
Of all rock and roll casualties, Phil's death was one of the least romanticised and became a tabloid-fuelled witch hunt.
He did get a raw deal at that particular time. I was pleading with journalists in this town, please, do me a favour, you know, write an opening paragraph without mentioning illegitimate and drug abuse.
He didn't die from an overdose. He died from pneumonia. And that's something that should be said, because I hate all these articles, oh, yeah, Phil Lynott, drug addict, died. That's crap.
I think I'm gonna fall to pieces if I don't find something else to do.
To those who knew him, Philip Lynott will always be remembered for his warmth, wit, and legendary charm. And 20 years after his death, it's his music rather than the myth which perpetuates.
He was just a beautiful guy. And, you know, the legacy is the music. right? Because we wouldn't all be here today. Now, if the music was a pile of shit, we wouldn't be listening to it.
If you have a dream or a vision to achieve something in your life, that it's possible to do it. I think that's the legacy that Philip and Thin Lizzy have for me, is that you can do what you want to do. It's possible.
You know that they say time has a way of healing. It can dry all the tears from your eyes.
He's left us with a legacy of great music. It's left me with a brilliant memory of a great bloke. And you know, when you think that you'll never hear any new Phil Lynott songs, it's really depressing, really.
Greatness, respect, and the fact that his music will never die. And that's, I think in a way, I see the comparisons, because I hope at the end of the day, people will forget his bad side, if it was bad. You mind, I'm talking about the drugs. And people forget my bad side because I did, in my own business, something I think better than most people. And I think he did the same. So I would hope that we both left the same legacy. And he certainly has with me.
He was extraordinary. There's nobody like him since.
I wish he was here.
Yeah, he had really long legacies, longer than mine.
Above all else, Phil Lynott was a Dubliner through and through. To celebrate his life, a statue was erected in the heart of that city in 2005, ironically, on the exact spot where Bruce Shields sacked him all those years before.
You'd love it. You'd be selling tickets, I think.
I don't know whether he'd be selling tickets, but I'm sure he'd love it really deep down.
How would somebody feel if somebody erected a statue? They're not going to erect a statue of Robbo in Glasgow, let me tell you. I don't think he would have wanted it. But then, Ian here, he's gone. It's there for other people to enjoy. I personally think it's a good thing.
He'd be very touched and very pleased, and I think it's fitting that someone that's given such a lot to the Irish music scene deserves something like that. I've seen statues for a lot bloody less.
I think he'd be up there smiling, yeah.
I think he'd probably be having a wry smile to himself. And probably saying to himself, Robbo, your hair's crap. Which I know he would. He should get that hair done. Get my mother and she'll wash it for you.
God bless, safe home, and all the best for the future.